Welcome back to our channel. I'm Michelle.
And for those of you that are new here, welcome to our channel. My name is Jessie. We are Moms on Crime, and in this channel, we talk about true crime and everything or anything paranormal. So today, Michelle has a story for us. So what are we talking about today, Mama?
I have another story about a terrible human being. Like always, true crime story. Before I get started, I just want to remind everybody, please go ahead and subscribe to our channel right now. And I'll jump into the video, right to my story. Today is a story about Stacy Castor. Do you know that name?
It sounds familiar.
Yeah.
Maybe as the story goes.
She's a terrible person. Mm-hmm. So, a little backstory on her. Stacy Castor was born July 24th, 1967 in Weedsport, New York. That is where she grew up. Her mom described her as like a really curious kid that always asked the question, why? And I have like a game that I like to play with little kids that are like, why kids, you know, that always ask like, why? Because my niece was a nephew just to be like that really bad. And I would be like, you know what? We're going to play a game. And whoever can be quiet the longest is the winner. And it used to work with them.
Because they're like, why?
So I guess you're just one of those kids, just like, she was just really active and very curious. So, I mean, she didn't seem like a bad person growing up, right? Mm-hmm. So at age 17 in 1985 is when she met her first husband. And they fell in love very quickly, and they got married in 1988, and they would soon have two children. She had her first daughter Ashley in 1988 and her daughter Bree in 1991. So her husband, he worked as an automobile mechanic, and money was tight, so I guess it caused a lot of friction over the years. And I don't know if you could describe it as jealousy. I don't know. I don't like when parents say like, oh, well, this kid's my best friend and I'm closer with this kid than this kid. Like, even if you feel like that, I feel like you really shouldn't say it out loud. But
then again, it's like, how though? Like, I have three boys, and it's like, and especially like they have different age, like, you know, with like the age and stuff. So I feel like, I don't know, you can't really have a favorite, and like you can't really treat them like the same at the same time, you know what I mean? Because like of their age, like the way you talk to them too, like it's different when you talk to the other one.
Yeah. So I don't know.
I don't get that either.
And it seems like it would cause a lot of conflict between the kids, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I don't know, it just seems like pretty unhealthy. But it said that Bree, their daughter Bree, was very close with her father Michael, and Ashley and Stacy were like really close, like they described it as best friends. I don't know, whatever that means, being best friends with your kid. I mean, you should be friends with them, like, you know, with
both of them.
But you gotta be a parent, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But Michael worked as an automobile mechanic, and Stacy actually worked as an ambulance dispatcher, and we'll leave the company name out of this, but Mama, it's the ambulance company that you and I used to work for, but in New York.
Okay.
For them. So money was tight, and just over time, they started to drift apart, and there was marital problems. And by the end of 1999, Stacy started to tell friends and family that she was thinking about getting a divorce. She wanted to leave him, and she just wasn't happy anymore. But by winter, Michael started to become like intermittently ill. Sorry, I can't say that word. But he started to get sick, you know, and family was really worried about him. And they said he was like really bloated, and he was just ill. He had a cough, and it lasted through the holidays, and everybody was encouraging him to go see a doctor. And you know how men can be, he just didn't do it. And early 2000, he actually passed away, and he passed away when he was at home with their daughter Ashley, and she was 11 at the time, and it was really hard on her. She blamed herself for a long time, and she just she went through a lot of mental anguish over it, that she felt like she could have done something. So there was never an autopsy done on him, and physicians just said that he died of a heart attack. And Stacy actually started to tell friends and family that Michael had been diagnosed with heart disease, but nobody remembered him ever mentioning that. Nobody, they said he never talked about having heart disease. And his sister and his family actually wanted an autopsy done, but Stacy insisted that one wasn't done. So it wasn't, because she was the wife and she had the ultimate say, and no autopsy was done. But that seems kind of weird to me that if a man dies and he was only in his like 30s, I think, it's kind of weird, you know, that's just really to young. Die of a heart disease or like a heart attack.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know, but they didn't do an autopsy. So 2003, Stacy met David Castor. He's the owner of an air conditioning installation and repair company, and she worked as his office manager. And they got married, and they didn't have any children together. And a couple years goes by. We get to August of 2005. So David didn't have an especially great relationship with his stepdaughters. I guess he was a little strict on them. And you know how, like, teens can be, like, that's not my dad. My dad died. You know, you can't tell me what to do. Kind of, you know. But I guess it wasn't terrible. So August of 2005, Stacy makes a frantic 911 call, and she claims that her husband had gotten in a fight, into an argument, and the day before he had locked himself in the bedroom with some alcohol, and he was threatening that he was going to hurt himself, but she let him be. And a day later, she called 911 saying that she was concerned because he wouldn't answer the phone, he wouldn't answer the door, she couldn't get a hold of him at all. So she called 911 for them to come do a welfare check on him. And she said they had been arguing about the children. So police come, they can't get him to answer the bedroom door, so they kick it in. And once they kick it in, they find him dead on the bed, and he's naked. And in the room, they find like alcohol. There's like a lot of different stuff. There's like a Gatorade bottle. There's like vodka. There's cranberry juice. There's Diet Coke, I think. And there's a shotgun under the bed. And they also find a jug of antifreeze in the room. And there's a cup that has antifreeze in it. So it looks like he commits suicide, that he drank, and then he drank the antifreeze and he commits suicide. However, the police that showed up right away, they thought it was odd. Before they even got the door open, Stacy was hysterical, screaming, crying, saying, oh, he can't be dead, he can't be dead. They're like, why is she saying that? And we didn't even have the door open, right?
Right.
So, also, they're saying that men typically wouldn't commit suicide by overdose. It's more like a female way to commit suicide or to drink antifreeze, because especially because he was an air conditioner repairman, he would know that drinking antifreeze would be a very slow and painful death. It would be terrible. And they're saying men typically, this is pretty gruesome, if they're going to commit suicide, they'll most likely do it by self-inflicted gunshot wound.
Right, yeah.
And women would typically overdose, right? And also, it's very rare for anybody to do it naked, because even though you're going to pass away and you're not going to see what happens, I mean, nobody wants to be found naked, right?
Right.
So they're saying it's very odd that anybody would commit suicide naked. So right away, police were like, yeah, it looked weird, right? And they started to kind of look around the house, and they found a turkey baster in the trash can, and they took pictures of it, and they actually collected it for evidence. And they, you know, took everything out of the room for evidence. And the thing that they found that was odd was David's fingerprints were not on the glass with the antifreeze in it, but two of Stacy Castor's fingerprints were on that glass. And then the turkey baster that was in the trash can had antifreeze residue in it, and David Castor's DNA was on the tip of it. But although they felt like the scene was very weird and detectives felt like this was not an actual suicide, they didn't have anything solid to arrest Stacy. So they just started to watch her and, you know, watch what she did. So David Castor was actually buried in the same cemetery where her first husband, Michael, was buried right next to him. Like, she had fought like a dual plot and put him, yeah, right next to her other husband. Creep, right? Like,
yeah.
Weird. So police first started to watch the cemetery to see if she went. Like, if you're a grieving widow, you're going to be going to your husband's gravesite, right? And yeah. She didn't. She never did. So, you know, over time, they were just kind of waiting, like waiting for her to do something else or waiting for, you know, some other stuff to come up. And so some time goes by. They ended up wiretapping her phone so they could listen to her conversations. They just wanted to see what she was talking to people about. And then they had cameras kind of overlooking the gravesites, and nothing really happened for a while. However, in 2007, they notified Stacy that they were going to go ahead and look into her first husband, Michael's death, and they were going to exhume his body. And that was at the urging of all family members involved. So that was her first husband, Michael, her second husband, David. Both of their families were really pushing the police. Like, neither one of these guys would have committed suicide, or, you know, David wouldn't commit suicide. Why would Michael suddenly die of a heart attack? Like, odd. So they were going to exhume his body. And that was the first time they caught her on camera going to the gravesite, was to go see if they were lying to her, if they had to see if they'd actually exhumed the body. Mm-hmm. And they did. So they started to kind of put some pressure on her. You know, they wanted to like get her riled up to see what she would do. And there was actually like an interview they stopped by and did with her, and they purposely left out the picture of the turkey basters. I guess she didn't realize that they got it. And she saw the picture of the turkey baster, and she was kind of freaking out, like, whoa, what is that? What is that picture? And they're like, oh, don't worry about it, you know? Yeah. So, it's September of 2007, and their daughter, Ashley, starts college. And I don't know why the police did this exactly. It's kind of messed up. I don't know. I don't, like, the kids didn't really have anything to do with it. But her first day of college, the police actually go to her school to talk to her, and they tell her, we exhumed your dad's body because we think that he didn't die of a heart attack. And she gets really, really upset, and she calls her mom. So the wiretap is still on the phone, right? So the police can hear the conversation. She calls her mom, and she's really upset. And she's like, why did the police come to my school and talk to me? And they're saying that dad didn't really die of a heart attack. And I'm just really confused. And her mom's like, you know, we've had like a really hard, you know, couple of days. You should just come home and come see me and let's just have a drink. So in an interview, their daughter Ashley was like, you know what? First I thought it was like cool that my mom wanted to drink with me because she, you know, my mom wants me to drink with her. Like, okay, I wasn't going to turn it down. So she goes to the house and her mom makes her a drink. And she said it tasted really gross, but she still drank it because she didn't want to hurt her mom's feelings. So she drank it. And she said, you know, later she thought it was really weird that she got really drunk off of one drink. She passed out, but she ended up waking up in time to go to school the next day. So she did. She went to college on her second day of college. And again, after school, she talked with her mom, and her mom said, just come over again and let's drink some more. That was really fun. I had a good time with you. So she does it. She goes back. And she said this time this drink was like disgusting, but she still drank it. And that's the last thing she remembers, is drinking with her mom. 17 hours later, her sister Bree ended up finding her in a comatose state in the house. And her mom's like, oh, I don't know. The last time I saw her, she was fine. She was walking around and nothing was wrong with her. But she's like comatose. So there's this 911 call her mom Stacy makes, and I heard the recording of it. And right away, she's setting it up like her daughter tried to commit suicide. Like, oh, I can't believe this is happening again. And she's just so upset over her dad dying, and she's never been the same. So she's automatically already saying these things on the 911 call. So her sister said she had been with her and in the room, saw her the way she was, like vomit, and she was comatose, and she was begging her mom to call 911. And She said she walked away for a second. Her sister Brie walked away for a second. And when she came back in the room, all of a sudden there's a suicide note laying there. And she said that note wasn't there when she was in the room previously. And the mom snatched it up really quick. And she's like, oh my gosh, yeah, she tried to commit suicide. Ah, right? So paramedics come.
Psycho.
Complete psycho. So they take her to the hospital. And thank God they ended up saving her. She didn't die, but as you know, she wakes up, there's detectives there, and they start asking her, like, why does she hurt herself? And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about. The last thing I remember is drinking with my mom. I didn't want to hurt myself. I'm fine. I just started college. I'm happy. And they said, well, what about this suicide note that they found next to your body? Your mom found the suicide note. And in the suicide note, get this, it's Ashley confessing to murdering her father, Michael, when she was 11 years old, and then murdering her stepfather.
No. David.
Yeah. And she's like,
gonna freaking frame her own child after she murders.
Yes, because Ashley's like, I didn't write that note. I didn't kill my dad and my stepdad. Like, why would I do that? I was 11 years old. I didn't do that. I didn't write that note. But police already knew it was like total bullshit, right? Because they knew Stacy did it. They already knew this wasn't true. Yeah. And the suicide note that Ashley had supposedly written was typed out. It wasn't handwritten. They said typically if somebody writes a suicide note, they're going to write it out by hand. Mm-hmm. They don't type it out. So police actually, you know, from the wiretap, they said that day, that first day when Ashley started college, there's other phone calls when they could hear Stacy on the phone with a couple of her friends and you could hear her typing in the background. And, you know, your computer timestamps everything that you do. Yeah. Even if you think that you delete it, it's still there. So they could tell by the timestamp that she was writing up a document at the time when Ashley was in school. So they knew it was all like crap, right? So they arrested her and she went on trial. And so she was charged with, let me find it for you. She was charged with attempted murder of her daughter, Ashley. And then she was found guilty of murder for her two husbands, because once they exhumed Michael's body, they found that he had the telltale crystals, I guess, that develop in all of your organs when you drink antifreeze. Oh, so they determined that he had also been poisoned. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I guess what she was doing with her first husband, Michael, was little by little, she was trying to poison him. Mm-hmm. And she couldn't get it right. Like, she couldn't get the mix just right with him at first. So she kept trying more and more and more. That's why it seemed like a long, drawn-out illness with him. It was actually her trying to figure out the right amount of antifreeze to give him. So they determined that he did die of poisoning. So she was convicted of his murder. And her husband, David, also. So they're thinking with him, she probably got him drunk. And probably drugged him with something. And while he was passed out, she used a turkey baster to put antifreeze down his throat. And that's why his DNA was on the tip of it. Yeah, like crazy psycho, right? And then her daughter at the hospital, they had found that she had mixed like a cocktail of drugs into the drink that she gave her. When I was at first like reading this and like watching different stories about it, I thought it was going to be antifreeze too, but it wasn't. She actually used like a bunch of different sleeping pills and stuff on her daughter to try to kill her. And I like, how crazy is that? That's your kid and you watch her for 17 hours to struggle.
Exactly. And then frame her.
Yeah. Because she knew the police were getting really close to her and she was panicking. So how crazy is that? That's your first thought is to kill your daughter and frame her and write a fake suicide note that she is the one that committed the murders.
Right. Isn't that crazy? That is just pure evil right there. It's like your mom, like with,
I know.
Like you carried that child, you know, like in your body, and how can you just do something so horrific like that?
Not only is she a black widow, but she tried to kill her daughter. Like, she's evil on so many levels. Crazy. Yeah, she is. February 5th, 2009, that's when she was found guilty of second-degree murder of her husband, David, and attempted second-degree murder of her daughter, Ashley. And there's a ton of different like shows out there on it, like Datelines and 2020s, mm-hmm. all of those. There's a lot of them out there. And I watched a show where it showed her daughter giving her victim impact statement in the courtroom. And that was just so sad and heartbreaking because she was talking about like how much she loved her mom and they were so close and she just couldn't believe, like she didn't want to hate her mom, but she just couldn't believe what she had done.
Yeah.
Her dad or stepdad and to her too, like try to kill her.
Exactly. Which one is she? Is she the favorite or the best friend? Oh my gosh.
That's the one that was supposedly Stacy's best friend that she was closer to, was her daughter Ashley, and their daughter Bree was closer with her dad, Michael.
My gosh. But, can you imagine like the heartbreak? Like
I feel so bad for that girl. When I was watching her victim impact statement before her mom was sentenced, it was just like I wanted to cry. It's so sad. I feel so bad for that girl. I feel so bad for her. And just thank God she didn't die. Can you imagine that, her name being slandered like that forever? People thinking that she's the one that did it. But I mean, that makes no sense. I would hope that police would have realized that made no sense and her mom actually did it. Because how is an 11-year-old going to kill her dad, like a grown man? That's like, I mean, I guess it's probably happened before, but I don't know. Crazy. That's
crazy.
Karma did not take long to catch up to Stacey Caster. She was actually found dead in her jail cell on June 11th, 2016. And it was determined that it wasn't suicide and it wasn't homicide. She actually died of a heart attack.
Oh, wow. So,
karma made quick work of her. I mean, pretty quick. It was 2016. So just sad. I feel really bad for her daughters, but I hope that they've found a way to move on and find some sort of peace. And at least they have each other and they seem like they're really, really close sisters. So I hope that they have some sort of peace in their life.
But that's crazy, though. It's like, that's your parent. Like, they're supposed to be your protector, like, somebody that's going to be there for you to protect you, not to harm you or frame you. What the hell?
No, I can't even imagine accepting that or coming to terms with that. That was your mom that did it to you. Mm-hmm. Your mom tried to kill you so she wouldn't get caught for murdering her husband's. Isn't that just like
that? It's just crazy. It's like, I picked my freedom over my daughter's life.
What is that, like a sociopath? They don't love like anybody. They don't know how to actually like love somebody. So that means like you never even really loved your kids. There's no way you actually loved your kids if you tried to do that to them.
How could you not? That's crazy. That's something I don't understand.
No. But there's a ton of shows out there if you guys want to watch them and just kind of see all the craziness play out. There's so many shows out there on YouTube, and there's so much that you can find on her. Complete psycho. Well, Mama, that is my story for today on Stacey Caster. I hope you guys, I know you can't really enjoy it, but I hope you like this video. And if you did, please go ahead and like it right now. And don't forget to subscribe.
Also, don't forget to put your comment down below. Let us know what you think. Or if you guys have any more stories that you want us to talk about, let us know. And don't forget to turn on that notification bell so that every time we upload, you guys can hang out with us. Also, you can follow us on our social media at Moms on Crime, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, and email us at our email, momsoncrime@gmail.com. And that's all we have for today. Thanks, guys.
See you next time. Bye.